The work that I want to present was done in Leipzig, and the goal was to add canonical text service support in Clarin. At first, I want to explain what canonical text service means. So canonical text service, or CTS, is a protocol for a web-based citable text service, or you could also call it a text communication protocol. And the idea is that it uses a URN notation to refer to text passages or text parts, like chapters or sentences or something like this. It was developed in the HUMA Multitext project by Neil Smith, and I was responsible for the implementation of a protocol that is now used in Leipzig in the BillionWords project. So the basic concept is that if you want to cite a text passage, you have to somehow narrow down the content of the documents up to the document that you mean. Then you have to specify the text passage. And if you combine this, you have one reference or identifier for one text passage in the world. And this is how this basically translates to a CTS URN. CTS URNs can be used to refer to text passages that are the complete document. You can also refer to each of the text parts. This can be done on any citation level, so it's a layered system, basically. Using the dash, you have the possibility to refer to or to build CTS URNs that specify text passages from one CTS URN to another one. And using the subpassage notation, it's possible to do this with token precision or even character precision. The integration in Clarin was done in the repository of Clarin, the Clarin Center Leipzig, and it may function as a template for further import processes, because normally, if you program something that works with CTS, it also works with one CTS instance, then it also works with other CTS instances. And what was practically done was that CMDI metadata files were generated that included the web service requests for certain passages as resources. This has been done, and I changed it a little bit. I hope it's still right. The data is available on three levels. So at first you have a collection. In this case, the collection refers to an excerpt of a parallel Bible corpus, a collection of Bible translations. One document is one Bible translation, and each of the documents has several resources. And some of these resources are the books of the Bible, like, for example, the book of Genesis. Here you can see how this looks in the Virtual Language Observatory. So in CTS, this is called a text group. And this is converted to a collection in Clarin. And for each of the CTS URNs on document level, one document in Clarin is created based on the meta information that is served by the canonical text service. Just as a side note, full text search is working, but it's not yet connected to the system. Here you can see how the individual books are included. We decided that citation level 1 is reasonable and actually enough to do. So one document has something 70 to 60 resources. The first resource is the CTS request for the complete passage of a complete document. Then you have the TI dump that was used as an input just to edit there. And then you have several links that have the same name, but actually they point to different resources. They point to the CTS requests for each. There's one link for every CTS URN on citation level 1. So each of these links, is one book of the Bible. So why would you do that? CTS, so there are two points that are not really technical. The technical stuff can be discussed later, but there are two points that are also important. CTS is developed by humanists, and it's further developed by humanists, and therefore it can be assumed that it reflects the requirements that certain digital humanity communities have on a text reference system. And a similar point, but a different flavor, is that creating CTS-ready data is something that is actually a research and project goal in digital humanities. So there are projects that deal with creating this kind of data to be able to refer to text passages using CTS URNs, to structural text parts. And this is a nice way for Clarin to pick researchers up where they wanted to go anyway, or maybe already are. There are also some technical benefits. creating an interface to a canonical text service is a way of normalizing a generic text access. It allows to outsource the text data, so it's not, you don't need to store the chapters or anything like this. You can just store the CTS URN and request the chapter data as you need it. And it's also a way to connect it to the canonical text infrastructure, which will be the issue for the rest of the presentation, basically. And canonical text infrastructure is basically a collection of data sets and tools and concepts that are developed in Leipzig in the Canonical Text Project. And one of the coolest features is CTS cloning. And it's actually quite an easy idea. So there's a certain output format that can be used to structure the data in your response, and this output format can be used as an import source for a new CTS instance. And this way, it's possible to clone one CTS instance and share the data, or split the data over several instances, or combine CTS instances to a new one. And this has the potential to create a decentralized, global, public text buffet, basically, where anyone can just install a CTS server and pick the text that he wants. And now it's even connected to the client infrastructure, which opens up Weblicht and so on. Or potentially opens up Weblicht and so on. using the structure information that is implicitly encoded in the CTS URNs, two alignment tools were created. One of them you can see here. So what you can see is that these are the documents, and each of the text parts is aligned based on their CTS label of the passage. Yeah? And the cool thing is that actually this works for some kind of data. Of course, the data must be prepared with this in mind, but if it is, then it works. And it's quite fast, so because it's just a number of CTS requests, basically. The second tool uses the knowledge about the language tag that is part of the CTS URN to visualize language variations in one translation, one language, yeah? Like, for example, here, the same text passage aligned for all the German, I think it's German, I hope it's German, German Bible translations. There's also a generic reader, which doesn't really look nice, but it's much better than the solution was before. you can, on the upside, browse through the documents. On the left side, you see the structural units that are that this document has. And here you can see the text content. You can mark up some text content with your mouse, hit citation, and then you receive a CTS URN for this text passage. one quite open project that mostly I'm working on when I don't have much else to do is the CTS text miner. And the CTS text miner is a similar concept to the CTS cloning, but instead of creating a new CTS instance, text mining data is created like a topic model configuration or topic models based on certain configuration or token frequency lists and so on. This text miner is a layered system, layered in as in REST specification layered. The lowest level is that you can request the raw data as a web service. The next level is that you can, instead of having the raw data, it gets transferred into some kind of virtualization. And currently, a student is working on the third layer, which is a user interface for the virtualization modules, which would then be a public text miner tool, basically, a text mining tool. These are the data sets that are currently included. So the Deutsche Textarchiv is probably well known in this publicum. Another data set, or the second biggest, as far as I know, is the Parallel Bible Corpus, which contains, I think now there are more than 900 translations of the Bible. Perseus is included, which contains several historic, ancient historic texts and is closely associated with the Digital Humanities Chair that is part of Leipzig University. German speeches, German political speeches by Adrian Barbarisi is included. Some law texts that are part of, I don't know where I got them, some public space where you can get the law texts. The TED subtitle corpus, which might be even a little bit unique because the TED developer API was closed in the beginning of the year. The TED, the data is the subtitle transcripts of the TED Talks. If you know them, there are 10 to 20 minute presentations of various scientists or interesting people, and they published the subtitle files in using an API. The API was closed, which means that this is, as far as I know, the only public source for this data now. The Koala project was included, and several more. The future work is basically expanding the infrastructure, and what this means is I want to add more data sets. It doesn't matter how big they are, just any data set is can be used for something. I want to add more tools, like generic tools that use the CTS as a communication protocol, or expand the text miner, add certain functionalities, add new modules to it. A group of students is currently working on a touch device reader, something like Kindle that is nice to use, which shouldn't imply that Kindle is not nice to use, but and there's also a citation analysis workflow that is already working. It's producing good results when Bible citations in the Deutsche Textarchiv are calculated, but it could certainly be improved. So it's actually nothing really special. And connected to connect the whole system to established existing projects, like, for example, Clarin. And yeah, that's basically it. Here you can see the contact information if you want to make contact. So this is me. I'm working at the Scalable Data Solutions project, which is a project to build up a big data competence center. And the three other people are part of the Natural Language Processing Group in Leipzig. And yeah, that's the slide, last slide, basically. The site you can read for yourself. It's from Nevin Jovanik, who, yeah, I thought it's the perfect use case, basically. That's it.
Thank you. This is very impressive. Great work. In fact, so much here that it's hard to see the impact of it. I think it's almost unlimited. But to the point, can you briefly explain your motivation for using URNs as persistent identifiers, whereas Clarin actually discourages this and proposes handles?
I'm not one of the specific people responsible for the specification, so the decision what that CTS that URN notation is used was done. I have no control over it. It's just part of the protocol, basically. But I found out that they work very well, and the implicit structure information in the CTS URNs is very useful. For example, with respect to the real-time alignment.
Me too. I wanted to ask something about URNs, and I wanted to be more specific. There is no generic resolver for URNs. Is there at least a resolver for the CTS namespace of URNs?
Not for the CTS namespace, but as part of the project that infrastructure will be, there's a namespace resolver for example, you have URN CTS PBZ as the parallel Bible CTS instance, and this will be resolved globally, simply because the goal is to have persistent identifiers that you can use in, for example, your paper. Yeah, then you just have a hyperlink, click on it, and get to the text passage. And so it must be sure that not someone cloned the data set and changed something or anything. So it must be the original source, and this will be part of the infrastructure soon.
So this is a question about the canonical notion and the particularly for the classical part of the corpora that you're looking at. We've been working with the Perseus collection. And, you know, particularly when you deal with classical works, there's a lot of alignment issues because there have been translations across the centuries, and also you have some computational linguistic work that's been done. People have done a part of speech tagging. And when you get to working with this, you find that nothing aligns properly at all. It basically just doesn't at all. And so one of the sources of this is that in the classical texts, these canonical notations were written in paper on the margins. So they really actually were quite ambiguous. And then past that, when you got into the TEI period, people used TEI in very, very different ways. So we have a pretty serious problem that has to be solved. I mean, we're working on this, but you really end up with totally misaligned materials, actually, if you try to use the canonical indexed, they really can't even use them.
Yep. That's right.
So you understand this, yeah.
Yep, that's especially...
So, we could talk about it later.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you for this talk. I have a kind of a question about workflow and maybe more of a comment about using a kind of TI bridge from one CTS instance to build another one. Maybe I'll start with a comment. So I know you're not working... directly within the Clarin team in Leipzig, but one of the nice tools that they have developed is the so-called TEI integrator, which is actually helping people who are not TEI experts to curate their data into the Clarin infrastructure, among other resources, into the German Text Archive. What would be very nice is if your TEI bridge, as it were, was interoperable with this TEI integrator, because it would greatly enhance the usability of what you're doing for Clarin folks, because they could then piggyback on this bridge that you've already built to from TEI to creating CTS instances. And that's actually my second question. Of course, you couldn't cover every detail in this short talk, but how should I imagine the workflow, say, if I have, or our invited speaker has a text that may be in TEI format or whatnot, how do you create CTS instances from a given text collection that's in a different format natively?
At first, so CTS doesn't necessarily have to do with TI. So it's, for me, it's just the import workflow because all the files that I used had some kind of TI format. But in theory, it can also be docbook or something like this. The connection to the TI integrator would be great. I mean, the connection to Clarion, it's just the beginning, basically. I forgot the third point. and the workflow. The workflow is actually that there's a quite flexible TI importer for the CTS. For example, using the Koala data, I just downloaded the TI dump that was prepared by them without any, they didn't know me or anything. I just prepared it, configured the import process and run it, and it was fine. So it's flexible enough to be used by people that didn't even know that they use it.
Are there other questions, comments? I have one. So do you also, would you cater for linguistically annotated text? Somebody mentioned part of speech tagging, but you could also have parsed stuff, etc. Would that?
Yes. I mean, part of a Perseus text are annotated with, so for me, the annotation is just text. Okay. So what one man's data is another one's metadata and so on. So.
Thank you. Okay, so let's thank the speaker once again.